Well, I know one of these guys. But he's not the coalition.
This one here might be a little more interesting.
Commissioner Brian Tam and Commissioner Jim Ball for their service on our commission over the years. So, Commissioner Tam, in the back of the room, so thank you for everything you do. Commissioner Brian is not able to be here next month, but we do want to thank him and his service. Also, this weekend, the Republican Party across the state of Georgia met. The Forsyth County is split between the 7th and the 9th congressional district. And in the 7th district, which most of Forsyth County is in the 7th congressional district, we were lucky enough to be able to elect a delegate to go up to the national convention in July from Forsyth County, and that's Carolyn Hall Fisher. One of three, there's three delegates and three alternates from the 7th, and then three delegates and three alternates from the 9th. And Carolyn's the only one that's come, that will be going to the national convention from Forsyth County. So we look forward to seeing her down there on the floor voting and having a good time and representing Forsyth County at the national convention. Tonight for the District 5, we have three candidates, Mr. Chandon Adams, Justin Hawkins, and Laura Semanson. And we've gone over the time previous, and they know the time. We have timekeepers up here in the front that's keeping track of that, and Joel Matt's doing the moderating for this one more time. And before we end and turn it over to them, just a reminder, School Board District 3 on April 25th, and School Board District 5 on April 25th. That one starts at 6, and the second one starts at 7:30 back here at this location. So hopefully y'all will be able to join us for that. So without that, I'll turn it over to Joel Matt.
Good evening again. Right before the debate, they all drew numbers to start. These are a little more difficult than a coin toss, unfortunately. Mr. Hawkins won, and he will go first with his introduction, followed by Mr. Adams, and finally, and I'm terribly sorry I'm going to mutilate your name the first time I said, so help me with it, Laura?
Laura
Semanson. Semanson. Thank you. And then finally, Ms. Monson will finish up with the introductions. Just like last time, we're going to have some questions and then a couple of yes-nos. I can guarantee you they're not all the same as last time, so if you sat there and made notes, you'll be surprised. So, Mr. Hawkins, you get to go first. You have 2 minutes to do your introduction.
I'm recovering of allergies, so please forgive me. I want to thank everybody for coming out tonight. And Joel, I want to thank you and the Republican Party for hosting this debate, and also Shannon and Laura. Thank you for participating. The main reason why I'm running for commissioner is very simple. I believe Forsyth County is at a critical crossroad. See, I was raised in the heart of South Forsyth. I'm a product of this school system. Congested roads, overcrowded schools, and getting hit with out-of-control growth is not something I learned about on social media, researched on the internet. I lived it. When we talk about kids going to schools in trailers, when we talk about eating on the hallway floor and in a cafeteria, I did it. Right now, we've had out-of-control growth plague Forsyth County. We've had to increase property taxes 3 times, and our county leaders had to acquire over $800 million in debt. Right now, District 5 needs a commissioner who has the leadership, the vision, and the experience to protect the quality of life, to preserve this community, and to give the citizens a seat at the table. On May 24th, I ask for your vote, but just know I'll work very hard to earn it. Thank you very much.
Just grab this. I must say that was very impressive. I'm not a very good public speaker, so bear with me. My name is Chandon Adams. I'm a resident of Forsyth County and a homeowner. My wife and 4 kids, we reside in Windermere. Most importantly, I have 5 beautiful children, 1 angel baby. I'm a lifelong Republican. I'm a lifelong Christian. I'm an entrepreneur, having successfully started 4 businesses, one of which I started while in college at Georgia State University. Many people ask, why am I running? I believe that Forsyth County needs new leadership. We need improved leadership. Forsyth County needs an advocate who will not seek endorsements, nor will be bound by special interest groups. Forsyth County needs leaders with a proven track record. This is what I promise. I promise to adopt the servant leadership philosophy. This is both a leadership philosophy and set of leadership practices. This philosophy shares power, puts the needs of others first, and helps develop and perform as highly as possible. I will promise to slow growth. I will fight to lower taxes. I will be the first forward-thinking commissioner that we've ever had. I will be your advocate. Thank you.
Good evening. My name is Laura Semanson. Thank you again to the Republican Party for hosting and putting together this event, and to all of you for coming out to help decide what happens with the future of this county. It's a big opportunity for all of you to get to know all of us a little bit better, because you're going to hear a lot of the same messages from a lot of the candidates this cycle. It's very, very popular to get on the smart growth train and talk about reeling in rampant development and those types of things. So you're going to hear a lot of the same messages, but what I urge you to do is to dig a little bit deeper. This election is about trust, and I think that a lot of us have become very jaded and lost trust in the system and what has happened and transpired over the last several years. 15 years ago, my husband and I decided to put down roots in this county, raise our family here. And we came here for the same reasons that most of you probably did, which is the schools were great, the community, sense of community was great, the beauty of North Georgia, and the quality development that was going on in this county at that time. My passion to run came from disappointment, basically, in the stewardship that we've had with that. In the 15 years that I've owned my home in Forsyth County, I've watched my taxes double, while I feel that the return on that has not been in kind. We've seen stagnant home values, we've seen overcrowding in our schools and our roads, and for too long, the taxpayers have had to pick up the tab for that. It's time for the taxpayers to take action, and they are the largest stakeholder, but they need to have the largest input as well. I just urge you to dig a little bit deeper. I'm the only candidate who's had an active history of involvement in this community for homeowner and taxpayer issues. I do not have any conflict of interest. I've never had any involvement in the large development community. And I am a homeowner like you. I've embraced transparency. Everything that I've had, all of my reports have been filed online, whereas I think others have not done that. I'm also the only candidate who is vetted by the Homeowners Coalition. Thank you.
Okay, the first question will start with Mr. Hawkins. Each candidate will have 2 minutes just to recap to answer a question before anybody will be expected to rebut, and each candidate will be allowed 1 minute to rebut their oppositions. First question to Mr. Hawkins. Do you support increasing development impact fees to fund various county items such as roads?
Absolutely.
Hey, anything else to say? Mr. Adams. Wait a second here.
Now you're on.
Now I'm on?
Yes.
It is a simple answer. I would advocate to raise impact fees, both residentially and commercially.
And of course, we're all in agreement here. I think impact fees is one way that we have seen a lot of potential revenue to this county has just gone away while we've sat and struggled with the issue. And it's time now to start making those parties as accountable to developing this community properly, as the taxpayers have picked up the slack on that over these years. $50 million of lost revenue in just the last couple of years. So it's a lot, and it's all on us. We don't start collecting from those people.
Any rebuttal?
I just want to make one thing clear. We need impact fees when it comes to residential development, because we've seen an out of control growth in terms of just that residential components. Right now, our entire tax digest is flipped upside down because we don't see corporate growth moving to the 400 corridor. We don't see commercial growth. We aren't ushering in businesses and smart places in Forsyth County, so I do not support impact fees on commercial growth, only on residential.
Any other rebuttal?
I would say that we definitely need to have the most force behind those impact fees, behind the residential development. That's where the biggest burden has been on our services and our infrastructure and schools. As for businesses, they do pay some impact fees. I think that there's room also for, if they do have impact fees, to have abatement programs. So companies that are coming here and providing jobs and providing a good tax return to us can be rewarded for coming here. I think that definitely there should be impact fees for them, but there should also be abatement programs.
As previously asked in the previous debate, Forsyth County has been cited as one of the fastest growing counties in the state. What type of growth do you each support, and why do you support it, and why don't you support other types? Actually, it is Mr. Adams' question first.
Can you repeat the question?
Forsyth County has been cited as the fastest growing county in the state. Specifically, what type of growth do you support, and what type of growth do you not support, and why?
Yes, we have been cited as one of the fastest growing counties in Forsyth in Georgia, but I think as citizens, as taxpayers, we have the ability to stunt that growth. We don't have to be the fastest growing county within Georgia. I would like to see the growth slow down. I would like to see some more smart growth approach, and we need to usher in the right type of development.
I'm going to try not to mutilate this. Semanson?
It's Semanson, but I know who you're talking to. Only one up here. The type of development that I would support would be, first of all, we need to try to attract more commercial development. And to do that, we need to start protecting and defining what those proper commercial corridors are. Secondly, I do support more residential. However, the kind of residential that is going to be self-sustaining. We cannot continue to try to drive and pack more people in here into developments that are going to have a flipped return on their taxes for the services that are delivered. So definitely the smart growth approach is what I would use as a guiding principle, but I think primarily we need to look at increasing our commercial development and having the good kind of businesses here that are going to deliver jobs, they're going to add to the tax base, that are going to make this community really shine and use the resources we have here in the way of people. We have a very highly educated populace, and they're getting in cars and they're driving to Alpharetta and they're driving to Johns Creek, and they're driving out of county for those jobs. We need to develop those relationships with those kind of companies and bring them here.
Hawkins. I first want to say the reason that we have this problem, the reason that we're the fastest growing county is a good thing, because that means we're doing something right. We have a great quality education system, we have excellent green space, and we're safe. And we have a unique quality of life. So just because that we're the fastest growing and we have growing pains, we need to deal with that. So I just want to say one thing first. I do not support developments that don't follow the future development map. I don't support not abiding by our UDC, not abiding by the zoning laws on the book. So if you live in Three Chimneys and Windermere or Grand Cascades or Chattahoochee River Club, those types of developments we saw over 15 years ago. We had different zoning categories back then. I want to usher in those zoning categories to attract and incentivize that type of quality development. That doesn't mean that because we attract doctors and lawyers that we shouldn't attract students, nurses, and firefighters and teachers. We need to bring continuity, and we have a comprehensive update plan going on right now, and we all three should be a part of it, and everybody in this room. So I support high quality development as well as commercial quality growth. It's the type of development, it's the type of negotiating and aesthetic standards that we need to raise. So that's what I support, absolutely.
I would agree that we need to up the level of what our expectations are from developers who are coming here. Our county is a jewel of North Georgia. We have amazing resources here, and for the last several years, we've seen it sold out from under us. We need to demand that the developers come here, bring their best products to us. We need to get a better feeling about ourselves as a community and what we expect from it. We do need to follow the UDC, and we do need to follow all of the zoning laws. And we need to stop giving away to those people who are not contributing. We need to make the development community accountable. We need to make sure that that we're having the kind of growth that we want here.
Any Republicans' comments?
Third question of the evening. What do you see the most pressing need for the county in terms of capital projects? Yes, you're first.
In terms of capital projects, obviously I think all of us would be somewhat in agreement that from a capital project standpoint, our roads are truly atrocious. The traffic in some parts of the county is a deterrent to bringing in quality growth, the types of businesses. They will not relocate here for that. Other parts of the county are suffering just because the roads are of such poor quality. So that is definitely going to be at the top of the list as far as things that need to be dealt with and dealt with quickly, just to get our roads and our traffic conditions up to snuff.
Mr. Evans.
I would have a top two. Obviously, those would be roads. Right now, our roads are congested due to the development that we're seeing here in Forsyth County. Also, we need to increase our sewer system, because right now the infrastructure is just not there to support the needs of our community.
I hate to reiterate it, but our roads are the number one pressing issue right now. We have congested roads, whether you drive on Highway 400, Highway 20, whether it's Windermere Parkway, Old Atlanta, wherever you live, you sit in traffic, and it takes you at 2 o'clock in the afternoon to go to the grocery store 30 minutes. That's kind of a problem. And so we do need to tackle that. We did pass a $200 million transportation bond, which I did support, because we had to solve our road problem. We absolutely had to. It was a controversial vote, but you know what? I'm going to stand firm when I need to and not back down, and we absolutely need those funds, and I hope that whoever is elected from District 5, works with their state legislators to secure the necessary funds moving forward.
Next question is to you, Mr. Hawkins. What is your experience with preparing and authorizing budgets?
Well, first off, I was the treasurer for the Forsyth County Republican Party last year, and I actually had a great time working with you all, and that absolutely prepared me to handle the budget. I mean, we handle thousands of dollars year end. We have expenses, and we need to make sure that our revenue doesn't exceed our expenses. Our expenses don't exceed our revenue. And the fact of the matter is, we need someone qualified not only to handle the budget, but someone also has the experience of handling the growth. I'm the only one on this stage that has experience on both sides of the aisle in the matters of zoning. I've negotiated with commissioners on one side, I've negotiated with commissioners protecting the citizens. And so we need someone who absolutely, we don't need on-the-job training, we cannot afford it. Forsyth County right now is at a critical crossroad. We cannot afford on-the-job training. We need people qualified right now.
Mr. Adams?
Well, I kind of disagree with Justin there. You know, my experience and my background is the only one up here that gives me the ability to handle a budget. I've created four different companies since the age of 21. I know what budgets are. Some of these are multi-million-dollar budgets. So again, I am the one candidate that understands budgets. We do need somebody with a little bit of experience. It's not just common sense. Again, a lot of this is experience, and a lot of it will be on-the-job training.
Yeah, so I'm going to completely disagree with your entire argument. I can look at my budgetary experience from two different ways. One, prior to becoming a homeowner and running a household, and I would use the same principles here, is we don't spend more than we make. But prior to that, I spent many years in the high-tech industry managing marketing communications budgets in excess of $1 million. So I am quite familiar with large budgets and how to manage that and how to provide accountability for those expenditures. As far as being the only qualified candidate, I would say that there's a lot of value to somebody who's been a 15-year homeowner and taxpayer in this county, who has shepherded her children from pre-K all the way to high school graduation. To try to claim that there's some benefit of experience when you're 25 years old, I think that's a pretty bold statement. Huh?
Mr. Hawkins, any rebuttals?
Well, I was the treasurer and handled thousands of dollars for this very party to get this room to host this debate. So, I mean, if we didn't have a treasurer that was responsible, we wouldn't be able to do these things. At 25, I'm the only one that actually has experience in negotiating the deals that are oppressive. Out of control growth, would you agree, is the number one issue? I think so. I don't think you've negotiated any sort of those deals. So I think that, yeah, I'm 25, I embrace that. I grew up here. I was raised by a single mother, the oldest of five children. I negotiated those deals. I know exactly what to do on day one.
Fear of Adams.
I don't have anything further to say.
Any further?
Well, you know, I embrace your youth and enthusiasm as well. I just don't think you have the same perspective. And, you know, I would like to believe the born-again homeowner advocate, but I just haven't seen the same enthusiasm behind homeowner issues until very recently, until you decided to run for commission. Whereas I've been active for several years working on homeowner issues. So just a different thing.
Next question is to you, Mr. Adams. Considering the current county budget, do you believe any part of the county budget in the future should be shielded from possible cuts?
Looking into the future, I can't really say right now, do I think any part of the budget should be shielded from future cuts. I will make that a priority once I become commissioner to look into the budget and see where we can make cuts. But to make that statement right now as to what should be shielded and what shouldn't, I'm not going to state that.
In the interest of me not mutilating your name, Laura, I'm just going to say Laura, if you don't mind.
That's fine. I would agree with Chandon's approach. I think that there has to be a little bit more time in the seat to understand where those areas are that do need to have some better management or need have funding issues. So I wouldn't boldly go out and say right now there's any one area that needs to be protected in particular. I think everything is open for examination, and there should be accountability for all of our expenditures in every department.
At 25, I think I adopted the best sort of budgeting philosophy. I believe in zero-based budgeting. I believe that you have to track every dollar amount that's being spent. Right now, by Georgia state law, we have to first give the law enforcement the necessary funding aside from everything else. So right now, we heard from the previous debate that we have a drug epidemic in this county. We're part of the heroin triangle. And right now, And in the nationwide, we've had a 3,800% increase in heroin-related deaths. I think the law enforcement needs to have increased funding right now, but I'm not going to say, I can't speak 5 to 10 years now what we could increase and decrease. But right now, we need to hold strong on our law enforcement budget.
Any rebuttal? Moving on to the next question. Question is to you. Do you plan to promote any changes to existing tax of the county?
Do you plan to promote any changes
to the existing tax formats in the county, property taxes, SWAT, etc.?
Right. Well, first of all, as far as property taxes go, I would be opposed just on principle to adding to our taxpayers' burden on increasing any millage rates or anything of that nature. I think where there's some big opportunity there is having a better negotiated distribution of the loss and SPLOS monies in this county between us and the city, and that we need to have more advocacy for the populace that is part of the county. That's a big area to help fill some of the gap.
Hawkins. I would absolutely pledge that I'm not going to raise any property taxes if I'm elected in my first term in 4 years. We have a merry-go-round of madness right now. We've been inundated with the high-density zoning, we increase taxes, and we acquire debt. And we just keep doing this circle over and over again. So I will make sure that we incentivize and we usher in businesses around the 400 corridor so we can balance our tax digest, so we ensure that we don't have to raise taxes on any more on the backs of the property owners.
I'm going to kind of echo the same thing. I promise the citizens of this county that if I am elected, I will not raise taxes my first year. I'm not a proponent of SPLOS or lost. That's all I have to say.
Any rebuttals?
Not raising our taxes has been one of the cornerstones of my campaign. For too long, we've carried that burden as taxpayers. So I absolutely pledge that I would not raise taxes. I would say also that I kind of challenge the notion that you're opposed to the high density growth, because I have seen your very own words supporting it, and I'm just concerned that you actually do support the Res 6s and the apartments and those types of things.
Well, there's no doubt anybody that knows me knows that I work for the most effective zoning attorney in the entire county, and they have a skill set to achieve results. I knew that's not what I wanted to be. I didn't want to become a zoning attorney. I went into pharmaceutical sales, worked for Johnson & Johnson. But after I became a private citizen, I also negotiated on the other way. I've negotiated for the overlay district. I've negotiated now for the Haversham sewer to be acquired by the city. I've negotiated on both sides of the aisle. And the fact of the matter is, people hire defense attorneys. Why? Or most defense attorneys have been prosecutors. Because you need to know how the other side works.
Please, no comments from the audience. Thank you. Mr. Adams, any rebuttal?
Okay. Mr. Hawkins, the next question is to you and to all the others. You all have said that you do not plan to raise taxes. If county expenses increase next year, how do you plan to accommodate those expenses without increasing taxes? Since you've all have said you will not support raising any form of property taxes, if county expenses increase next year, how do you plan to meet those expenses without increasing the tax burden on the citizens?
I think that we need, if we have expenses that are now incurring higher than our revenue, we need to look at every budget and start with zero-based budgeting. We need to track every dollar in every single department to see what we can cut. And I think that we don't need to take anything off the table.
Mr. Adams.
Yeah, again, it's going to be digging into the budget, seeing where we can make cuts, obviously looking into the departments and seeing which ones are efficient and which ones are not, and then making our cuts there. But we don't need to raise taxes in order to do that.
And I would agree with that as well. Better management of the money that we have coming in. We collect a lot of taxes in this county, and our return is not proportional. So I think there's definitely room for examining every budget and looking where we can make cuts, and things that are the want-to-haves will have to wait, and the things that have to have will have to come first.
Next question is to you, Mr. Adams. as mentioned by one of your opponents, what actions would you have taken regarding the Habersham Water wastewater project? What actions would you have taken regarding the Habersham wastewater project?
What actions would I have taken?
Yes. Or would you take? You can consider it either way.
So, the whole Habersham issue is a very complicated issue that's between the county and the city. So, it's going to be somebody who's effective within the county doing effective negotiations with the city in order to get this Habersham debacle fixed. Again, I don't have the perfect answer for the Habersham fix right now. I don't. But I will promise Habersham that we will look into it, and we obviously will try to come up with the best scenario.
Laura?
So I actually have worked with some of the people who are intimately involved with that that situation. And I will tell you right now, it is a complicated situation. And frankly, the county commission has very little say in it. What we do have as a role, though, is to advocate for the county citizens, not to advocate or try to bend to what would be beneficial to other parties outside of our own. I would also argue that this is a situation that we're going to see come time and time again. There are ticking time bombs, literally, all over this county of sewer systems that were private that will someday need to come under the purview of either the county or the city. So our role as commissioners is to bring forth the interests of the county residents. And so I would support them in any way necessary to make sure that negotiations are done on their behalf with the city to have some kind of resolution to that situation. And it's not going to happen overnight.
So I'm glad that we're discussing this issue. It's one of the most pressing issues in District 5. And so the gentleman up front who I met with was Mayor Ford Raven. I met with the leaders of the Habersham Action Committee, and I met with the property owners all in the Habersham area. 400 residents are on a private, outdated sewer that was zoned back in the 80s. It's not between the city and the county. It's between, really, the residents who run the Habersham sewer. They've run it for over 11 years. And so I met with Ford Raven. One of the first things I did. We have a commissioner now who does not get along with the mayor of Cumming. And this issue has been really a product of political animosity. So I'm throwing that aside. You need an advocate, you need a negotiator, someone for the residents of Habersham. Because the city of Cumming has a sewer line that runs parallel to the Habersham sewer. It's an easy fix, you can tap into it, but we need an advocate who can go to the mayor, who can go to the city of Cumming and negotiate a good deal, and it's going to be my first priority if elected as commissioner.
Any rebuttal? Next question is to you, Laura. What would your solution be to attract large-scale and high-quality employers to our county, given the current status of building?
I think the first cornerstone of that is going to be for us to look through this comprehensive plan that's in play right now to properly develop what we see as a vision for commercial corridors. Tying into that as well is we need to kind of massage those relationships with the Google Fiber, getting that in place so that those types of employers have a source to tap into there. We also need to proactively get out and market our community for the benefits that we have for those employers. We have a very highly educated, technically savvy group of people that live here in this county that, as I said earlier, go elsewhere for employment. So we need to be able to capitalize on that as a resource. We need to be actively out courting those types of businesses, and we need to have our UDC under control so that we are having a proper place for them to go, so that development follows that code, so that roads are being developed appropriately to service that, and so that there's the quality of living that the CEO and the C-title people in those companies are wanting to live in. They don't have to go live in Milton, or they don't have to go live in Alpharetta. They can come here.
I absolutely believe we need to protect the land around the 400 corridor, because we need to compete with Roswell, we need to compete with North Fulton, and put tax incentives to usher in high-tech corporations. I mean, our tax digest is completely flipped upside down. We can keep updating the comprehensive plan, but if we don't follow it, it means nothing. And I think that, you know, I think our school system is absolutely of the highest quality. I'm a product of that school system. But the fact of the matter is, it's the largest employer in the county. If the largest employer in the county is the Forsyth County School System, we're not ushering in the high-tech corporations and the regional offices that we need.
In order for Forsyth County to attract employers, again, it's going to be about branding our county. If you look at our surrounding counties and you look at our surrounding communities, the reason that they are able to attract these high-profile corporations, large employers, is because they have a very good brand recognition. They also have the development already in place for when these corporations want to come. When corporations come to a new county, city, community, whatever, they don't want it built. They don't want to build it. It needs to already be built. It needs to be in place. The infrastructure has to be there. And again, we just need to do a better job at marketing our brand here in Forsyth County.
Mr. Hawkins, the next question is to you. What is your position on the creation of any additional cities within the county?
I was raised in the heart of South Forsyth. I've lived there. I grew up in Three Chimneys. I live in James Creek now. I totally understand why the citizens want to bring back local control. I think it's a shame they didn't get a chance to vote on it this year. I hope they get a chance to vote on it soon.
Mr. Adams, what is your position on the creation of any additional cities within the county?
Again, if it's the will of the people and they want to create a city, then let it be the will of the people.
Laura.
So I think there's a balance that has to be struck here, and I definitely support the voice of the people, and I intimately understand the frustrations of the people who have brought forth the Sharon Springs movement, the Bethelview movement, some of the other areas that are investigating cityhood. There is definitely an impact to the rest of the county. I know some people see it as a redistribution. But basically, I think there's another way to address some of the issues that the cityhood movements have brought forward, and that's that we have a frustrated populace here who, as unincorporated county citizens, really have had no say in what has happened in their little part of Forsyth. I think the ability for the, whether it goes a township route, whether it goes a city route, whatever it is, I think that people have to have some input, and they should be a deciding factor in that. But we can't dismiss the fact that it does have impact outside of that local community. I think looking towards things that will give remedy to those people for their zoning concerns, their variance concerns, their code enforcement concerns, to be able to define how their communities look and feel, where they live, that's important. But again, I think there are a lot of different ways to address that, cityhood being one, townships another, consolidation being yet a third. So I think there are a lot of ways of looking at this and not making undue impact on other parts of the county.
I do want to say the objective to really create a cityhood is really to kind of slow down the growth in South Forsyth. That's the main objective. But the fact of the matter is we have to simultaneously look at other objectives like changing the structure of how we elect the Board of Commissioners. I support a hybrid model where we have four district commissioners and one countywide chairman. That gives South Forsyth the three votes it needs to ensure that we have better quality development.
Any rebuttal?
If we're looking at the way that we have the county commission set up, I actually advocate going back to more of a countywide model. I think over the last several years, we've seen increased tensions between different parts of the county. And District 5 is a little unique. We are neither a southern nor a northern county, a part of the county. We're a hybrid. We're a bit of both. So our concerns, they might be different at the ground level. But at the bottom line, we all are concerned about the way our communities are developing. So I think that I would support going back to a countywide model where everybody has accountability to everyone else.
Since we went down the avenue, I will pose the question. What is your position on countywide voting versus district voting for all the commissioners? Mr. Adams, you're first.
Again, it should be up to the people of Forsyth County to decide if they want countywide voting or District 5 voting. There are benefits to each type. The district voting obviously gives me the opportunity, gives me the opportunity to run for office. It gives others who want to run for commissioner the opportunity without spending large amounts of money to run for office. But again, it should be up to the people whether or not they want to do countywide or if they want to do district voting.
I agree with the people having a say in that. Of course, my personal opinion is that the countywide model that we had previously was more effective. In the last several years, as I said, we've seen fractionalization, people just kind of separating and only feeling they had a responsibility toward their own area. So I would definitely, as I said before, I would support going back to a countywide model. Whether there's some hybrid version of that would be more effective is to be determined. But I definitely think that the people should have another say in that. And there should be accountability from every district representative to every other district. We're a county. We're not districts. We are one county. We are Forsyth County. And we all have responsibility for paying for what happens in different parts of the county. We need to recognize that it's not a battle between us. That's pretty much my take on it.
7 years ago, we had countywide voting, which means you can vote on five county commissioners. Right now, you can vote for one. We had countywide voting. It was passed by the people to bring it back to district. Now people are unhappy because they feel that South Forsyth particularly feels that they don't have a voice at the table, don't have enough of a voice as they did. That's why I believe in a hybrid model. It's going to be very hard for the courts to bring us back to countywide voting. Has been vetted pretty thoroughly. So I believe in a hybrid model where you have a county chairman and you have four district commissioners. It's the perfect combination, and it gives South Forsyth the three votes they need to be represented at the table.
Any rebuttals? Laura, the next question is to you. Do you feel, no, changing question, sorry. Would you support privatization of any part of the county services, and if so, which parts and why?
I think if it was a cost savings to the taxpayers and if it was a more efficient model, those are definitely some things that could be investigated. I don't have anything right on my hot list right now that I think that would need to be immediately addressed through privatization. However, if that is going to provide a benefit to the taxpayers, it definitely would be something I would be open to.
Right now we have a pretty conservative leadership in our county government. It's pretty lean, so I don't think that we need to privatize anything right now.
I would be open to privatization. Again, if we can save money by using privatization in different services, I'm for it. Again, I'm for less government, so anything that we can privatize, I would be for it, assuming that it's beneficial.
Any rebuttal? Seeing none. What is your definition of quality of life, and how can it be preserved within the county? Mr. Hawkins, you are first.
Yes. I think quality of life is defined by the individual, but I believe that if you have to go to the grocery store at 2 o'clock, it shouldn't take you 45 minutes. I think that if you have to eat lunch in the hallways or go to school and your schools look like trailer parks, I don't think that's the quality of life we want. I mean, we have a very unique quality of life. We have a lot of growth because we're doing a lot of things right. We're adjacent to Lake Lanier. We're by the on the foothills of North Georgia Mountains, and we're 30 minutes away from Atlanta. I think that we need to protect the land that we have around 400 to preserve it for businesses. And I honestly think that our school system is fabulous. So we need to make sure that every child, we keep classrooms small. And so I think that our unique quality of life is definitely something to be sought after, and I think it's defined by the individual, but that's my definition. Mr. Evans.
Well, again, quality of life is an individual perspective. When my wife and I decided to move to Forsyth County, that's the main thing we looked at was the quality of life. What brought us to Forsyth County? The schools. Also, It was the sense of community and the values that is shared within this community. Also, we looked at the natural resources. We can access the lake. We have an abundance of parks. So again, those are all things that my wife and I looked at when we decided to move to Forsyth County. Thank you.
As we've all said, quality of life is defined by the individual. I would also say that a very concise way of putting it would be to come home to a place that you love to be. And all of us came here for a reason. Some of our reasons are different. Some people came for the great outdoors. Some came because they had children entering school age. But as we see those things starting to change from what we dreamed they would be and what they were, and as they're shifting, we need to regain control of that. So quality of life is very different to different people. But I think that the unifying thing is, do you come home to a place that you love to be?
Any rebuttals? No. Mr. Adams. Do you feel campaign contributions from people doing business with the county could present a conflict in your decision-making if you are elected?
Absolutely. Again, I started this campaign. It's a true grassroots campaign. There are absolutely no special interests. There are no special groups, and I have no hidden agendas. So, yes.
Flora.
I, too, am running a grassroots campaign. I'm proud to say I've not taken any type of the special interest money, just because I don't even want the hint of any impropriety. I believe that can color people's judgment. I think there are people who come to public service with the idea that they're going to stay above it, and they can be tempted by that. So because of that, I have taken all of my contributions from individual homeowners like myself, and I believe I'm the only candidate up here who currently has their campaign contributions online.
Well, mine are online. I'll show it to you right after the debate on my iPhone. I have not accepted any money from development or special interests, and I think it's a testament to your character. Are you going to be bought and sold for, or are you going to stand up for what's right? You know, I'm the only one on this stage that's actually stood at that podium against tax increases. I'm the only one that's negotiated with commissioners to strengthen our overlay district. I've put in the years of necessary work to understand the process and the players and the issues. So I think it matters when people accept contributions from the development community. That's why I have none.
Yeah, Laura, mine are online as well, so. Okay, right.
Laura, can you turn your mic?
Yeah, I don't know if you guys want an interaction between us or not, but he stated that he had his online, which I would agree that he does, but it is not collecting more than $2,500, which means that you do not have to disclose anything. Essentially, and you trust that the campaign does not collect more than $2,500. Just for point of clarification. You do have that online. I will agree with that. You do have that affidavit in place.
Laura, the next question is to you. As this is a Republican debate, and you qualified as a Republican, who did you support in presidential preference? And if they are not the nominee, will you vote and support the nominee in November? And if so, if not, why?
Well, he will not be the nominee because I supported Rubio. So I can confidently say that I will support the nominee.
Mr. Hawkins.
I was the chair for Marco Rubio's campaign here in Forsyth County. I have worked tirelessly on the leadership with the Forsyth County Republican Party, working over 20 campaigns to get conservatives elected here around the state. I'm supporting Donald Trump for president.
I also voted for Rubio, and I as well will support whoever the nominee is for the Republican Party.
In the interest of time, we're going to do a couple of yes-no questions. I was asked to clarify one from the previous yes-nos, and I'm going to do my best to clarify before each of you get to answer. The question I pose is, what is your position on changing the senior citizen property tax, property school tax exemption? And just so everybody understands, this is a question from the Democratic Forsyth County ballot. And the ballot question is basically reads that should somebody that is over 65 that has somebody in school still not have the tax exemption? Should they basically lose their tax exemption even though they're over 65 because they have somebody still in the public school system? So it's a yes-no question. Do you support it or are you against something like that? It's a yes-no.
I support leaving the senior exemption in place. That's however that's worded.
Okay, so
it's a little tricky wording there, but yes, I support the people who have been here and paid the system all those years, that when they do get into their retirement age, that they're not still contributing to that system. I think there have to be checks and balances, obviously, but yes or no. there's your extended yes or no answer.
Mr. Hawkins.
I do not support repealing the senior exemption tax. If you're 65 and you have three kids, graduate from the public school system, and you're not placing a burden on the community, why should you have to continue paying that tax?
Mr. Adams.
I'm with the other two candidates. I support in leaving the tax exemption.
Thanks.
Can you qualify the question?
No comments from the audience again, please. If you wish to ask them after the session, you're welcome to have a one-on-one conversation. We have about 10 minutes left. Each of you are entitled to ask your opponents one question. You'll have 30 seconds to pose the question, and they will have up to 2 minutes to respond. Or you get to go first on asking the questions. And you have to say who you're posing your question to initially. But all of you will get the right to. So
I ask one question, but both of them answer it?
You have the right to ask a question, they both are entitled to answer, but you have to pose who you're addressing the question to for the sake of who goes first.
Okay. Oh boy. I guess my question would be, I'll direct it to Chandon because I know the least about you, so that's why I want to ask you. What are your thoughts on transparency, and how would you carry that forward? How would you present yourself in a way that people would understand where you're coming from, what your agenda is, what of a campaign trail, but then once you're in office, your accessibility and willingness to basically open the coat and work with the taxpayers.
Thank you for asking that question. I will kind of pat myself on the back for running this campaign and as being as transparent as possible. I have provided every bit of information about where I have lived, where I have worked, what I have done, what community involvement I have done. Everything is online. I have done town halls. I have done meet and greets. I've been knocking on doors. I've been the most transparent as I can be. If I am elected commissioner, again, I believe transparency is very, very important. Right now, the people of this county feel disenfranchised. They do not believe what is going on within the commission. And I put this on my website. I will make sure, and this will be one of the first things that I do once elected, is coming up with a group of elected people that make up a board that will do transparency audits on a quarterly basis within the commission, so the people of this county know what's going on.
I believe that transparency starts with accessibility. So I vow I'll be the most accessible commissioner that's ever been elected. I've visited over 90% of every subdivision in District 5 trying to get to know the voters. And so I vow to you that I'll be extremely accessible and transparent from day one.
Mr. Adams, you have 30 seconds to pose a question to whichever of your candidates or both of them,
and they will each have 2 minutes to respond accordingly.
Okay. Because we are here at a Republican debate, again, I think we all share the same conservative values. Again, that's why we're running for office. We're asking the Republicans of this community to vote for us. Again, you want us to be transparent. So I asked Laura, in 2008, which Democrat did you vote for? Hillary or Barack Obama?
And I'm going to answer that with neither. I neither voted for either one, and I knew that this was going to come up. I actually had spoken to Barb Luth about it. In that particular year, and it was maybe a kind of a lark, I've been registered as a Republican my entire life, but we decided, my husband and I, and I'm sure you looked his record up as well, that we were gonna do something kind of a sabotage and just make our vote not count for either of those two. I feel very strongly that the path that we're down with Obama and the path that we could be down potentially with Hillary are terrifying. So
you did not pull a Democrat ballot?
I did not.
Thank you.
I actually don't have a question for either one because it's not really about us, it's about you. I think that it's great that three of us are running for District 5 County Commissioner. I think that the citizens really do need a voice, and whoever will be elected needs to hold that to be truth. So.
It's time for closing remarks. As Laura went last on the opening remarks, she gets to go first, and then Mr. Adams, and finally Mr. Hawkins.
So obviously, we've all heard a lot of the same kind of remarks with regard to how we, you know, all feel about growth and those types of issues. I think where we are different up here is key, that I'm not presenting myself as a politician, but as one of your peers, as a homeowner who's been invested in this community for 15 years, who has raised children in this system, and who has made this my home. I'm not coming out of any type of desire to hold higher office. I think that's admirable for those people who do, if that's their choice. But my service is to you, the people. I'm passionate about protecting this community for your family and for mine.
First off, again, I'd like to thank everybody for attending. Participation is obviously the key to getting out our vote and for getting the citizens involved. So thank you again for attending. Again, we have a huge decision to make on District 5. Do we want to elect people who have the wrong interest or who have special interest or special agendas? Or do we want to elect somebody who may or may not have enough experience? Or do we want to elect somebody who is a proven leader, who has built businesses, who is forward thinking, and is doing this for the people? Thank you for your time.
Mr. Hawkins, I want to thank you, Joel, and the Republican Party again for hosting this. I want to thank the people for coming out. Listen, I've said it over and over again, I'll say it again, I'm from South Forsyth. I went to Davis Creek Elementary, I went to South Forsyth Middle School and graduated from South Forsyth High School. I grew up in the neighborhood that Laura lives in, Three Chimneys, and I currently live in James Creek. I understand this community because it built me. I understand the fabric of what makes us great. The fact of the matter is, we are at a critical crossroad. We've been inundated with high density zonings, and we've had to increase property taxes 3 times in our military, acquire over $800 million in debt. What will Rock County look like in 20 years? I want to live here for the next 20 and 30, not 5 or 10. So I have, I think, a long-term investment in this community.
I want to thank you each for your time tonight. Mr. Mock.
Thank y'all again for coming out. Let's give these candidates another round of applause.
Thank you.
give Joel and Natt, our moderator, a tough job to be the moderator. The next room, April 25th, is School Board District 3 and District 5, and early voting starts May 2nd. So please mark that on the calendar if you'd like to get out there early. So thank you all for coming out.
And everybody needs to be registered to vote by next Tuesday.
Right, that's right.